Good morning, everyone. I hope you're living it up this morning. If we show all around here, we're living it up. Should be living it up.
Yeah.
I hope everybody had a good evening and everything is working out the way you want it to be. We're going to get right into what I feel I want to discuss this morning with you. Just want to give God the glory and let Him just bless all of us as we talk about things that need to happen and people we need to see and do something about and help. Thank you, Jesus. In your name, amen. Now, got some headlines. Let's talk about the 50th anniversary of the Watts resistance expressions, what some of you like to call it, right? Mm-hmm. But whatever it is 50 years. And the question is, in these 50 years, has anything changed? Where are we? Is the question. Are we where we want to be? And if not, why not? These things have to be dealt with if we're ever going to overcome our problems. I mean, 50 years, and I don't know what somebody will say. I'll just give you my opinion. It was a few things done that changed the landscape of Watts, but as far as the underlining problem, it's still there. It's just been covered up and layered up, but it's still there and is alive and kicking. It hasn't changed. And until we begin to acknowledge and attack that, all of us in one force, it'll be another 50 years, maybe. Because I don't know how long that can go on like that. You know, every day is something else is going on with the police involvement with one of our people. You know, last night I think it was a woman shot as a result of something that she looked like a suspect. And she was shot and killed. So we're still doing these things You know, and it's way overdue for some resolvement of it. Way overdue. We changed police chiefs, councilmen, mayors, the whole gambit. But through all that, nothing's really changed. We have to acknowledge the fact that we too play a role in everything that's happening in our neighborhood. You know, I know people be saying, you know, black on black crime, and which is true. I mean, we definitely have to stop that. But you look at the cause of that. I mean, you go back, you know, it's just like it's inherited. It goes from generation to generation. We'll burn up our own bed to make somebody else mad. We'll burn up our bed and make somebody else mad. But then we don't have anywhere to sleep. And the situation, it hasn't changed. It just shows you that is where we come up with trying to deal with our problems. And that'll never work. You know, some things that's in being developed that we hopefully that we'll be announcing in a futuristic thing. But right now, I'm just looking at what we can do as a people, you know, to be able to change our community right now. But it begins with individuals, that we have to change ourselves along with our neighborhoods. Until we change ourselves, the have-nots and the haves, the middle class, the upper, all that has to come together to me before we can make a change. That don't mean we all have to live together, but that means we all have to live together. That's exactly what it means. And until we come to that point, we're going to have problems. And I'm not trying to oversimplify it, but it is a pretty simple thing. You know, you need to stop some of a lot of negativity and replace it with positive things, positive thoughts, trying to set your life right. I know some of us are so far into ourselves and into the thing we're into, you can't see the light anymore. But you can change. There's no doubt about it. I was one of them, so I know you can change.
Can I ask a question?
Certainly.
I think I may have my thing too loud. But, you know, being a product of this city, this state, born and raised in Los Angeles, Watts,
mm-hmm.
I remember as a little girl, about 5 years old, looking out the window, seeing the people try to strike matches to set the furniture store on fire across mm-hmm. the street, and they were carrying couches on their back and just doing kind of crazy stuff. But I want to know, really, because I know there were churches then,
right?
Where are the churches today, and how has the church evolved in being a place for people to get their lives together and change their mindset?
Well, first of all, I'm not speaking for all the churches. I don't know where they are. I can only give you my perspective. First of all, what is the purpose of the church?
I'm asking
you a question. What is the purpose of a church?
What is the purpose of the church?
The church.
I think the purpose of the church is to bring the people together, the gathering place for people to come and fellowship and learn about the Word of God, learn right. about God,
mm-hmm.
You know, mm-hmm. in all the many facets that God is. And I think the church is a place for us to get familiar with each other on another level.
Mm-hmm.
Other than, you know, just seeing each other at work or in the streets or at the house, we get a chance to experience each other in a spiritual way, because I remember seeing my sister shouting and, you know, jumping up and speaking in tongues and stuff like that. You know, my mom playing the piano. So that's what I think the church really represents. I hear the word institution. It's an institution of learning for us on a spiritual level.
Mm-hmm.
How about
okay,
that?
I couldn't say it any better. I want to bring it all the way up to the 60s and see how the church was used for the civil rights movement when it was kicked off. The church was the focal point. The church was headquartered. That's where everybody met, at the church. And after they, you know, they would have special services just dealing with the civil rights movement, because everybody would come and everybody would meet there to do strategies. This is what we're going to do. We're going to meet. We're going to go to church and get prayed up. And then we're going out and do what we have to do.
That's major.
And then they had one leader that they all agreed upon. This is the one we're going to follow. And he agreed that this is what he's going to do. Okay? Wow. Now, and that's in the church. And I'm going to bring it up again. I'm just trying to show. So I can only go by, you know, I read the word. I know what the church is, what it is. And I look at what I've saw. Now, I'm not saying in this situation, if we ever needed one now, we need somebody to arise out of these things to become, assume a leadership role.
Well, I say that's you.
Well, see, that's your opinion. That's your opinion. I respect
that's
it.
You.
I respect it and everything. But I'm telling you, I'm not saying that for that. I'm just saying that that's what we need to come out and begin to let everybody say, okay, here's where we could come to. To get this thing worked out, we're gonna meet at such and such. We want everybody to come and bring your solutions to this problem, and tell you what we need to do. We got the manpower.
I believe.
We got resources.
Yes.
We got everything we need.
Yes.
We don't need the government to do this.
Just need each other.
We just need leadership. We just need somebody to come in.
Leadership.
To come in and show the. How we can take some of the emphasis off of the pastor, because a lot of us put a lot of emphasis on the pastor. God bless him. He's not asking for it, but he had to be very careful, because he's not in competition with the Lord.
He's not in competition.
Because a lot of times that's what people to give him. They give them too much accolades and things that's happening. He's a shepherd. He leads us. I know, but. We have to understand that, and we have to give all our allegiance to God first. Search. What is it? Search yourself. See if there's any wicked in me.
What's that song? Search me, Lord. Search me, Lord.
You see, you got to see if there's anything in you. And if it is, Lord, take it from me.
Yes. If you find anything,
take it. Well, it ain't going to be hard. But it's just like, if you find, it's there.
It's there.
Get rid of it, please.
Oh, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord. But I just feel as though until that really happens with an understanding, we got a lot of powerful, wonderful preachers in our city, people. It's there, and some of them are already leading, but it's in their own realm.
Right.
We need an overall leader. We got to come together to fight this devil, this enemy.
Well, I agree with you 100%. And like I said, you as a person, a knowledgeable person, a powerful person, I believe you must begin this thing. I think you need to institute this thing. And I see it as a letter, a nice formal letter written. And that letter, you know, is addressing all the points and the things that need to be handled and dealt with in each church setting. I do believe it's like a blueprint that you must put together, and we can hand deliver it. I'm saying we now, because I'm on your team. We can hand deliver those letters, those packages to each church. From henceforth and now on and forever, this is how we're going to carry out. Because if we don't, then we're responsible for it failing, because we know the way, we know the truth, and we didn't institute it.
You know, as you were speaking, I could see, because see, with an understanding, I always like to have be decent and in order with these things.
Praise
because
the Lord.
I'm not,
praise the Lord.
I'm not trying to usurp any of that. I can't.
That's all right. We understand.
But I do see it's coming in where we are and what we have at our disposal. It could be done
right here at RMC.
Could be done. You know, and I would consider that in that vein of what you said. And I feel as though until that happens, though, again, we will have problems dealing with this particular enemy and the spirit of it. This is it traveled all the way down in these generations, all the way, all the, go back. It follows all the way, and it can be dealt with. Again, we have the resources, we had everything to deal with it on. It's just having the resolve. to say enough's enough.
And enough is enough. I was saying that last week.
It's too much.
Enough is enough.
Yeah.
I truly believe, even with us having this show, the Leon Watkins show, you know, there needs to be the Leon Watkins report. So after this show...
All right, you know me.
After this show is done, we are to take our bullet points and put them in a written form somehow.
Mm-hmm.
And on Sunday morning, come Sunday morning, the pastor needs to be aware of this show. We'll send them this show in an email and what we, you know, talked about and what we like to see, what we desire to see, and what we believe is a mandate, because I'm sure it's going to be backed by the word of God.
Right. I couldn't do it without that.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe we could bring some of them on and we could talk about it. You need to get a committee with them.
Definitely.
And then say this is the way we want to go. Separate and apart, what they, I don't want to interfere with you doing, but this has to be a wide thing and how we're going to approach it differently mm-hmm. than we have been.
Do you remember Religious Relief?
No, I don't.
There was a program in the schools, and I believe it was sort of like the elementary schools. It was called Religious Relief.
Mm.
Based on your religious beliefs, you could take time out to go pray, study, do what you needed to do, go to maybe across the street there was a house or a center that they could go and pray and have Bible study, and then they go back to school.
Mm-hmm.
I find that we need to look that up and see if there's any laws against it. And if it's not, something on that nature could happen at the church, the local neighborhood church. Children, after lunchtime, we're going to walk over to the church. You have to get the permission, I'm sure, parents' permission. Mm-hmm. And we're going to walk over to the church, and it's like vacation Bible school. And we're going to hear this message, and we're going to talk about how to love your fellow student and how to show, you know, love and if you see anything that looks like danger, you know, what to do, and you know, give them the key points and what to do, because this is serious.
More than serious. It's see, that idea is, it's something that could be developed. It sounds good to me, because we need to start at a level.
Mm-hmm.
Getting our youngsters back involved with it. Yeah, because the way it is now, they growing up on electronics. Mm-hmm. It becomes what they know how to master, you know, and it's, they're further and further away from the truth. And we have to bring them back. Nothing wrong with electronics and everything, you know.
Now, on that subject, technology, electronics, my young cousin, isn't that a good Pit Bull energy drink?
It's really good. I support it.
Yes, yes. My young cousin is now in Arizona, and his dad told me yesterday that he has been creating apps, we call it applications, computer apps and computer programming since he was like 3 years old.
Mm-hmm.
So now he's 26. He said he's probably forgotten more computer information than most people have learned.
Exactly.
So I called him up yesterday. I said, hey, could you help me develop an application for my family love project? And he asked me what would that, you know, basically look like, or what would it include. And so I started telling him some things. He said, oh yeah, that could be done. And is it something that they can go back and ask questions and find it? I'm like, yeah, you know. So I'm like, boom. He says, I'll write you up something and give you a price. There's money in creating apps.
Sure it is. I know.
If our children learn computer programming, that's a job.
Of course.
That's a business.
Yeah. It's any of that. Not only the computer. What if you learn how to fix these things?
Yes.
You
don't
get behind
computer
the thing.
Computer
repair.
So,
or all that.
In saying that about the apps, we can create
anything we
an
want.
Application that can teach them and give them the knowledge that we want them to, you know, like say the model neighborhood, build an app for the model neighborhood.
Yeah.
Cleaning the windows of Mrs. Smith because her husband is passed on and she's 85. Know. Mrs. Smith, I'm going to come clean your windows. Oh, thank you, baby. Here's $10.
Yeah.
You know, time has gone up. Cost of living is it. But, you know, creating that as an application, and they're playing these little video games, applications that we created. to help their minds right. develop a new exactly. way of looking and seeing their neighbors, especially their seniors.
And see, that is important because that's what has been a complete entity has been left out to me in our communities, the seniors.
Yes.
We don't have enough people that's concerned about them, which I want to talk about briefly right now, and you took me there, but I was wanting to talk about it anyway. As we all know that there's a heat wave here in Los Angeles.
Mm-hmm.
They say it's going to be here till the first of next week.
Oh, really?
And everybody here don't have air conditioning.
Oh.
Especially our seniors.
Oh.
And I don't know about you, but I feel that are we looking in on our seniors and our neighborhoods and the community enough to be able to help them? If you go by and you see some of these seniors don't have ice or don't have these things, maybe we could help them.
Well,
be able to go and see what they need in this time, in this very crucial time.
I agree.
Because they can't go out and, you know, to see if the city, you know, some cities give, when they have these heat waves like this, they give them fans. They give them if they don't have any.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we need to find out what is being done when these heat waves come for the seniors.
Well, I mean, excuse me, how can we find them? What can we do?
Call your city councilman. First of all, to see what they got. So we'll know where we stand and what they're doing, or if they're doing anything. We need to go from where you would figure where the funds and everything would be.
But I'm talking about the seniors. How will you know that a senior is in need? Watch.
You have to begin. You have
on
to
on the porch with a fan.
Well, you have to just, you have to know your neighborhood.
Okay.
See, that goes back to what we're trying to do. Back when I was coming up, I knew everybody in my neighborhood.
Okay.
I knew who's moving, who came in. You know, when I moved here, the people came to my house and said, "This is how we're here to help you." Blah 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 blah. Oh, you know, yeah, they came, and it made it a lot easier.
Well, is there like neighborhood councils?
You got them. You have to find
and
out.
And they should know
they should
all
know.
The residents in
should,
the blocks.
But you should know your little. You should know your little area. At least know four or five people on either side of you. Okay, two or three.
Yeah, we're really going to have to get busy.
Well, this is the only way we're going to solve our problem.
And
though.
I don't think it's a hard thing.
No, it's just diverting and making choices. That's all.
I don't think it's you a know? Hard thing.
Because we waste, how much time do we waste talking to people and things that we don't really, not doing us any good at all? We're just doing it because that's what we like to do. This is important enough to help save somebody's life and help develop what we're trying to do in the neighborhood. This is not just something that we're just doing to be doing. It needs to be done. Okay. And sometimes you can take away a half hour to an hour of your time to go and check on a senior citizen or find out what's going on with them is well worth it. That's where I look at it. And it's part of what we have to do, organize. And we have to quit, like we talked about the last time we were on this, we have to quit trying to lay this problem on somebody else's feet.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
When do we all take it responsibility? We all have to take responsibility. It's not so-and-so's problem. Like it's our problem.
Yes. Yes.
And we don't see that. We say, well, if so-and-so's over, we paying him. So he, you paying him as being a figurehead for what you do, but we still have to be together to help.
Wow. And, you know, you're speaking of that. My own mother, I don't even know if they have air conditioning in her apartment over there. I know my sister's there and my daughter's there as her, you know, caretaker
well,
and everything. So I need to go
that's
over
good.
There. And Mama. Bless
yeah.
her heart. She sits up and sleeps all the time. But yeah, he's like, okay, Crystal, come on, get her up out of there. Let's go somewhere.
Well, you know, the thing is, I just look at whatever you decide is in your heart to do with you. You know, you got a senior person. It's time to start doing it if you're not. That's the only thing. If you know they're there, sometimes it eats you. You wonder what mama doing, grandmama doing. I wonder who's so-and-so. But you don't do anything.
Mm-hmm.
It's just time for you to act on it.
Mm-hmm.
You got to go see about them every now and then because especially now they need it.
Yes.
You know, seniors, people need to see their children, their friends every now and then.
Yeah. I think it'll lighten their hearts. I think a lot of hearts are heavy. It's a lot of things going on. But, you know, I was reading this book that a man wrote. You know, I went to Atlanta last week, and we were part of the expo of the Hoodie Awards, the expo there. So I was a part of a book publishing company, and we were in the little booth there, and people were coming up with their books or wanting to know about how to get their stuff published. So this guy brought a book, The Ugly Color of Racism in America, or something like that. So he, you know, was talking about various things, you know, the Emmett Till situation and the hangings and the trees, the lynchings and the bombing in Tulsa, Oklahoma, you know. So I'm going back to that because it did something to me as I was reading it. On the way here today, I was reading it, and it was like, oh, my God. And then I thought about what has been said here in South Central, how they're trying to destroy so many people in so many days. And I have just been praying and just been rebuking that spirit. I'm like, God, where are you? I know you got eyes to see. I know you got ears to hear. I know you got a mouth to speak. Speak, Lord. What, you know. So it's really a situation that people's hearts are heavy. They're dealing with fear. They're dealing with loneliness. And some of them have already had someone taken from them.
No doubt.
You understand? So we are seemingly dealing with something that we've dealt with before. But we got to do it differently. We cannot have fear. We got to show love. I'm like, you know, let's get out here and start praising the Lord, playing our tambourines and beating our drums and just, you know, dispelling that evil spirit. Because if not, it's just going to sit heavy on us as a city, as a you know,
country. Well, you know, what you see, that's one thing is part of what you just said. But the other part of that is that we have not carried through all the way. We get a victory over here, and then we start celebrating. And we still celebrate. We got a little victory, whatever. If they build a shopping center or whatever, we celebrate. And we celebrate for 20 years.
Wow.
And we don't do anything. It has to be, we have to have a goal, and we can't celebrate until we finish.
Wow.
You know, to the point of that big celebration, because this is what it's going to take. You see, what you were saying is that after, if we look at it, just from the standpoint of what the spirit, the evil, whatever, it's a fact that God has said, told me, I've given you everything you need. And he told one of them, I forgot which prophet. He told one of them prophets, get up, get off your knees. What are you praying for? I told you what to do.
Well, what to do? Praise him.
Go out, listen to what he said. Go out and do what I told you to do.
And?
Go to work. I've already answered it. I'm not going to do it for you.
Go to work and do what?
Begin to put the ideas out so we can start working on this problem.
Okay.
He's given it to us already.
Okay, so we got to get out there.
You got to start
knocking on doors.
You know what you got to do? You have to get out of the boat. Remember, Peter was the only one that got out of the boat and walked water.
That's right.
But if you don't get out the boat, ain't nothing going to happen. You in the boat because you're scared. It's a fearful thing. They're going to do it. People are going to blah, blah, blah. So we on the boat. And Jesus is standing out there in the midst of it, standing out there on the corner, telling you to come to me. Come on out here and do something.
Oh, my God.
You know, it's time. It's way overdue. And that's for everybody. It's not just for in the inner cities or the cities. It's for everybody. Mm-hmm. It's time for you to lay aside your fear. Mm. Some of you people have undue fear of black people. Mm. You see a black person, you start shaking.
Wow.
You know,
that's true.
And how you gonna really work and
grabbing your purse and all that stuff.
How you gonna work with somebody and try to do and make a difference if you're scared of them? They be telling, well, let's go get up on the roof. Jesus. Okay. Whatever you say, that's not what we're talking about. You have to tell the truth.
Say doing it out of fear.
I mean,
right.
We can't work out of fear.
We gotta do it out of fear.
But we all have to get out of that boat and walk our own water.
My God.
And see, we haven't looked at it from the standpoint that we have the answers. Nobody's asked the questions. Nobody's really doing it. We've laid it at everybody else's feet. Where's so-and-so? I don't see so-and-so no more. And where he's over there. Well, I saw him. He said, who's these people? Uh-huh. They don't live in our neighborhood.
So we can't depend on
them. They're not
going
to come down here and do this. We need. They'll come down after they see after we done made a big change. Then you invite them down to speak. Mm-hmm. I can't pay them, mm-hmm. but they can come down and speak. Mm-hmm. But I'm just saying it's time for us to take responsibility of our own neighborhoods.
Well, I'm going to lead the praising because, you know, that's my thing.
Well, see, it's a place. Wait a minute. The praise went before Joshua.
Yeah.
Before the walls came down.
Yeah.
The praise, the one went out first.
Come on here.
They were the one doing it, setting it up. And the warrior was behind the praise. Now, you look at in the Bible, and you look at all the battles and all that. That's the one I seen that the praise went out with the harps and singing tambourines.
Yes.
They out in the middle of the battle.
That's what I'm talking about.
Praising.
So we do have a need
but I'm just
for
giving
praisers
you, I'm just giving you
to really
you
break
well,
that
that's understood.
Ugliness in the environment.
That's understood.
So that we can
understood.
Do that. We can
of
create a praise team.
We can do whatever we have to do.
Well, I want to do that.
Well, fine, done. I want somebody else to call. Put a number up. Somebody else can call and say what they want to do.
I don't know how to put the number up.
Well, what are we doing?
No. Well, 323.
Yeah, there you go.
965.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I thought I saw it lighting up. 1600. If you want to call in the studio, we have about maybe 30 minutes left. 323-965-1600.
You're not on
miss
it.
Us.
Go ahead.
You want to give your number if they can call you.
323-481-4850.
232-481-4850.
232. 323. Did I? Wait a minute.
That sounded weird to me.
You don't supposed to listen to my every word.
Yeah.
I mean, people can figure that out. They know what that meant.
323-481-4850. Now, that is his direct line.
232.
And I'm telling you all to call him because he does have the answer. I am very grateful to know Leon Watkins and to be here. I'm actually at the helm of the engineer, which is not my general status. That's why I couldn't put the number up. But I had to stand in for the young lady who was here late last night doing the show, and she missed her time, the alarm clock or whatever. But that's how we have to do. If one is missing, somebody has to jump in there and get into the place because we got to get this thing together.
You see, that's funny you would say that because that's what it has to be. You didn't know it. You know, you might have something else you had to do, and now I'm inconvenienced. So I mean, I don't know why. Then you come on and do something, and you're all bitter and angry, and
oh, wow.
Talking about I come,
that.
I got to do. See, well, that's the attitude that has to cease and desist.
Yes,
we have to be willing to help our neighbor as ourselves, and have a good spirit about it.
Yes, that's good.
We only as strong as the weakest one among us.
Mm.
We're only as strong as the weakest one among us.
Mm.
That means we have to go to the weakest one and lift them up.
Yes, I like that.
Lift them up. Don't kick them down.
Talk about
it. You know, what's that old saying about the Christians, the only one that kill their warriors?
What?
Mm-hmm. The Christians.
Oh,
we get it. We see one of us down, we don't lift them up. We just put our foot on them.
That's a shame.
That's just old saying. That's not me.
That's a shame.
I just thought I'd just dump this throwing stuff
thank
out.
You.
It's
that's
my
not
show.
You.
I can say
that's
that.
Yes.
The can Leon I say
Watkins
that? I can say
show.
It.
It's the Leon Watkins.
I said it.
Watkins
some of us
show.
Christians be beating up on each other.
Well, we can't do that.
And then,
anymore.
And
she
then
said enough.
Well, see, the problem is enough. Here's the problem with that, though. Here's the person looking in and saying, well, if this is what this is all about, I don't have no. This is worse than out in the street.
How do you do with it?
Mm-hmm. I've heard it said before.
Wow.
And, you know, we have to look at that. You know, when you're a Christian, you got a responsibility as being a Christian. You represent. You're talking about how these kids, about they represent, and they represent with their life.
Hmm.
We represent with our mouth.
Hmm.
We're not really giving our life for Christianity.
Oh, yeah.
We're just talking.
See, that's a part of what you were talking about that needs to be discussed in these offset meetings that we want to bring, talking about religious relief, but just what's the blueprint that we're going to present, you're going to present. I'm going to be backing
okay.
you up.
Right, thank you.
But definitely, it needs to be done. I mean,
yeah. Well, we're going to cover this because I've seen it sitting here, though, how we can do it. I didn't see you be saying it before. I didn't know what you how you want me to do it. That's what happened to me when I started working in the community. What am I supposed to do? But see, now I begin to see it. I thank
as
God
you
for
went,
it on.
It unfolded
it. I heard you.
And unveiled itself to you.
Which leads me into, while we having a break or anything?
You want a break?
To go. I don't need no one. I'm just saying. I'm asking you. You're the engineer today.
Well, I mean,
engineer, do you want one? Because I'm ready to move on.
Well, we can move on. I mean, I have a few more songs if you want to play some.
No, I don't need no more songs
right
now.
Okay, come on. Let's keep it talking then. Keep it talking.
No, I want to talk about, I was in the hospital last week.
Oh, yes. Bless you.
And as you know, I'm on dialysis, and every now and then things happen.
The phone's lighting up.
Well, answer it.
Okay, well, you're going to need your headphones to hear.
Well, take them.
Hold on just
do
a
I do? I need them?
Okay. Oh, my goodness.
Turn it.
Oh, what is that?
Okay.
I don't know what that is. Okay, hold
turn,
on.
Can you turn it down?
Hi, caller. How are you? Oh, this is Brian Franklin. He wants to say something. Hold on. Let's see how we can do this. Okay, can you hear us?
I can hear you well, thank you.
Okay.
Excellent. How are you, Mr. Franklin?
I am great. I am grateful, and I am honored to have this opportunity to talk with you at this moment.
Wow. Well, what did you have to share with Mr. Leon Watkins?
I just want to, as you know, Crystal, I'm one of your biggest fans. No, you know that's true, and I appreciate you laughing. That's your humility coming out. As you know, I'm a change agent, and I just tuned in. I just heard a couple of words from the brothers. I don't know his name, but I heard something that inspired me. He's a change agent, and I want to collaborate with him. So you know what I do, Crystal. So if you can enlighten how you feel we can collaborate in the capacity of creating solutions for our community, I'm looking forward to moving forward in collaboration.
My. Well, my brother, I'm so grateful in hearing your voice and saying that, because I don't see any other way of going over the problem over and over for many, many years. That's what we've done. And I had a friend of mine that would say, if you come to me with a problem, a solution better be right behind it. And I think that we do, some of us have good solutions. We just don't say it, because we used to giving all our problems to someone else to deal with. And I feel that until we all get together, because we all are a recipient of the problems in our neighborhood, we should be the recipient of the solution together. And we just need a focal point to rally around, and that is what's been lacking to me. And that's what you're saying. We can all be together. I think we can begin to address this problem.
Amen, brother. So let's start here. Crystal, are you aware of my work with Brad Carson with JobsCreatePeace.com?
No, I don't believe I'm aware of that work.
Okay. Brother, I'm sorry. Cause again, I just tuned in. I heard a couple of words. Are you a pastor?
I'm an ordained minister.
Okay, very good. I also am bringing a model to the City of Refuge. I recently joined the City of Refuge to be the change. As you indicated, you can talk about problems, but if you're not bringing a solution, then it's just talk, okay?
Yes, sir.
And so I've launched a unemployment model for 0% unemployment at the 17,000-member church called City of Refuge.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And I've laid out a very specific plan to make it happen. And one of my partners is Brad Carson. Brad Carson was very involved in the Truce of the Bloods and the Crips in 1992. Brad has solutions. And what we know, we can preach all we want, we can chant all we want, and the chant that you hear in the underserved communities around the country is, no justice, no peace, okay? But watch this. What we know is, no jobs, no peace, okay?
Exactly. Exactly.
And we solve the jobs, now we're going to have peace. And so Brad's work, when you go to jobscreatepeace.com, that's where I want to start with you and your work. Brad is also a minister. Brad is a long-term probation officer. He's retiring soon. And when he retires soon, he'll be able to take his work to the full scale of the problem. We deal with solutions. We don't talk much about problems. We know it. It's the problems that have been talked about. So I'm here to serve. Crystal, please make note of jobscreatepeace.com, please. And if you would, Crystal, at your earliest convenience, send me an email, and then I'm going to send Minister some data back where we can begin to collaborate under the auspices of Jobs Create Peace. It is a solution to virtually eradicate the crime in the underserved communities nationwide. I'm Brian Franklin, and I approve this message.
All right, Brian.
That is awesome. Thank you so Thank you. Much, Brian. Thank All
right,
you so
now let's
much.
Guys get back to doing what to do. I love you, and I'm here to serve. And Crystal's got to make sure we get this holy hookup, because talk is cheap. Now we got to do the next act. Matter of fact, I'm going to send you an email right now, Crystal.
Okay.
Forward that to Minister and copy me so I have his email address and his contact info, okay?
Will do. I think he may have a question or two for you. Did you have something
to say? Oh,
he
got, no, I'm not running.
Oh, brother, you explained it all. You know, next time we talk, it'll be some real heavy stuff, okay?
Ashe, amen, and shalom, okay?
Peace be with you, too, my brother.
Ashe, brother. Love right. you. Love
Thank you,
too.
You Brian.
My pleasure. Thank you for doing what you do, Queen.
All right.
Wow.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, yeah, we could take this up.
Yeah, shoot.
I have had Brian on my show, on my Wednesday's Woman show before, mm-hmm. and he introduced something, I think, black365.com, mm-hmm. and there's so much more to him. He has oneimall.com, where you know, shop on this one site, and many vendors are there, and he's a very powerful genius of a brother.
Okay.
He had someone to bring that definition of a genius is a person that is a creator, someone that creates something.
Right.
So you're a genius, I'm a genius. We are geniuses when we have the opportunity and ability to create
yes.
something. So thank you again, Brian.
I start calling you Queen.
Oh my goodness. But you know, he's one of the persons that I had in mind to connect with you. There's another brother, Raymond Hall, and CJ, Dr. CJ Frank, I was going to say CJ Franklin, CJ Forrest. I think it's not Forrester, it's Forrest.
Okay.
So there's some very prominent men that have come into my life to you know, enhance me as a woman, because see, there's the fact that the woman is to learn from the man,
mm-hmm.
and then she carries that forth to the children and the other mm-hmm. ladies and things. But it is really for the woman to learn from the man. And when you find a woman that is with the man and he is not as knowledgeable or in, you know, intellectual as she is, it's not a very good scene. It's not a very good relationship. You have to really learn how to balance that thing out.
Well, since we, you know, he's bringing that up by the knowledge. What if it's the woman that's taller than you? Anyway.
That's probably
anyway, that's
but no, you know what? Because that's a real thing.
Mm-hmm.
Women that are taller than their mates sometimes are comfortable. Sometimes the tall man seeks out the shorter woman to.
Mm-hmm.
It's a balance in his mind, because he doesn't feel that he's has to, you know, be on that same level with her. She's on that same level with him. He wants someone, and then the other, she kind of feels that, you know, or he feels, you know, the man, mm-hmm. the shorter man feels, you know, I'm mightier.
Right,
I got this talk.
Right.
It's a very interesting mental
thing. Anyway, I just, it's curious.
I'm 6'3", just in case you guys didn't know.
Yeah, it is something to walk up next to her, and she's towering over me, you know.
And, I'll tell you.
That's not important right now. No, we're not into height and all that. Just forget that. I can do that.
Oh, he said I can start it and shut it down at the same time.
Because we need to move on.
That's the
I'm 5'9" and a fourth.
Oh, look.
I like to throw the fourth on to make sure that I get every inch of that, you know. But it's something to be able for us to acknowledge who we are.
Yes.
And show that the things we talked about have no bearing on anything as far as what we have to do. We can't let that be a stopper, because we let stuff like that stop us from doing all kind of stuff.
Physicality.
This thing that we have about ourselves that
we
can't go out. I'm not looking right. My hair ain't right. I ain't got this on. I don't have the right shoes. And so we don't do things.
That's major,
you know,
in our culture.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. We're going to have to change that.
Definitely.
But that's an individual thing. You have to change it. If you change it in your domain, I'll change it in mine. I'll do whatever I have to do. Well, that's where it has to be done.
We need to show more of that then, because it is a real major problem.
Well, anyway, as you said, I wanted to get into my hospital stay if I can.
Yes,
you know what I'm saying?
I
mean, I'm trying.
I called him. He was in the hospital, ladies and gentlemen. I was like, oh, my God.
Yeah, I was in the hospital. Being on dialysis, I've been on dialysis since 2000.
Mm.
And every so often I have bouts.
Okay.
You know, things happen, you know, you have to go. And I went in. And my thing is not about me being in the hospital, because that's just part of what I'm involved in. The Lord is taking care of that.
I
trust him. So, you know, I always plan on coming out.
I
go in there and make a little vacation out of it.
Okay.
You know, they feed me pretty good, you know, and everything's cool, you know what I'm saying? But my point is, it's the people that I saw that were serving me, serving the patients, mm-hmm. the nurses, mm-hmm. the sister to the nurses, the folks that's in there daily trying to help you. And I was watching that, and I was looking at what we have in our community, what we need.
Mm-hmm.
How do we serve our community the way that I was served in that hospital by these people? I know they're being paid and everything, but you have to have a certain thing about you to be serving, be a caretaker, in other words.
Yes, I understand.
You could be a patient, because some of us are very difficult. I don't consider myself a difficult patient. You know, I did what I was told, as long as I felt like it was
reasonable.
What's this for? Why are you doing that? Blah, blah, blah. I just, you know, I want to know.
Okay.
But just saying that we need to be able to serve our community.
Mm.
I can't tell you how, and in that respect, you have to search yourself. But that has to happen. We got to serve our neighborhood. We got to serve our neighbors.
Mm-hmm.
We have to show. You have to use decent and in order. You got to know how and know what you're doing. But if you see some people walking down the street, homeless or something, and you know that, why don't you give them something? You have something extra. You throw away. Do you know how much food we throw away? Even the poorest person, so-called. We fill up these trash cans. Them trash cans are full.
We do that. I see
of
that.
Excess food that we just throw away that's still good.
I can't stand that. I don't like
you know? But see, these people are standing right over here next to you. It's one thing that I would like to do. I've seen it somewhere. I'm trying to figure out where. Instead of giving out, looking for pennies to give to these people, why don't you make up these little care packages when you're riding down and put them in your car? You know, if there's women, you can give them what they need for their personal need.
Mm-hmm.
Well, for maybe some a little toothbrush, a piece of paper, something that they could use instead of giving just a little something. Go to the 99 system and get us some stuff, make your little packages up, and give them that. And then put some maybe a few quarters in there, something they could use to adapt to travel around. These are the things that's going to begin to help.
Hmm. Well, yeah, there are groups that actually do that.
Okay, groups can't do all of it. That's what I'm saying.
Right, right.
Yeah, I understand what you're saying, because we're putting that their thing. But it's so many people.
But what are we going to target first, Leon? Because I think, more importantly, our mindset as a people and how we deal with one another and how we deal with our own selves needs to change. You know,
well,
you got people going
first.
To work, you
that's
got people
first.
Going to school, you got people just standing at the corner, not homeless, but just standing out there,
right.
Drinking, smoking, you know, doing things. How are we going to deal with that?
Well, we have to, first of all, like we're saying, we're doing it now, dealing with the people. We have to get people together to believe that we don't want on one accord, that we can make a difference. You start out by organizing properly.
Okay.
Because everybody's not even going to be on it in the beginning, then we'll be in the as we go.
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
you have to get the right people to be with you that can have the same vision as you do, and begin to brainstorm. So what is the best way to proceed? I have my opinion. You got yours. Somebody, mm-hmm. and then say we can come to it and see this is what we want to do first. You and I have to begin to get a little lightweight committee together.
Mm.
That's like-minded, so we can see which way to proceed.
I agree 100%.
Because I'm not the dictator here. I mean, I have ideas just like everybody else.
Mm-hmm.
And see, some people are already in place. We can do certain things
mm-hmm.
immediately.
Well, it's just like,
you know?
Brian linking up with those who already have a part of the program.
Excellent.
And the plan. And
excellent.
Then we just advance.
We will advance that and put it in place and see if we can get to see how many we can get.
And there are nonprofit organizations, as I said, that give out those little
packages,
toiletry hygiene kits and things.
I know them.
So you do know them?
Some of them.
So then we can connect with them. So I say we use this show as a platform. We contact them. We address a little letter to them, inviting them to come here to meet with us. This is an establishing moment here, how we're going to put our, you know, forces out there to use, because we need some immediate results. We're not talking about next year and all this. We're talking about next hour or so, making change. I'm just talking.
No, I'm hearing you. I mean, I can understand it, and I am on board with it 100%, because I feel as though without having these things, what we're doing, it'd be another 10 years at least.
Wow.
Because I don't see the direction. Just think about it. Brother Obama did a wonderful job. He's on his way out and everything, and we've had that. And you look back and say, okay, the biggest difference that happened, you know, we had a black president. Did it come down to where I'm at? Did it affect my, you know, how's it affecting us?
Mm-hmm.
Do we know how to utilize what we got? Do you know how much money we spent last year as consumers?
How much?
$300 or $400 billion.
Well, it went up.
Yeah, it went up. But how many have we did in the last 10 years? You're into the trillion, right?
Well,
now, wait. Now, I'm saying is, see, we have this idea that we don't have any power. We have this idea. That's why some of us act the way we do. We're hopeless. You know, I don't do it. I can't do it. As any individual, we can't compete. But as a people, if we move together, we have money. We have power. We have bargaining power.
Well, it's definitely proven. It was the same thing I remember Mohammed Nasruddin with Recycling Black Dollars was doing. He said, every chance you get, put a dollar in another brother, in a black man's hand, or something like that.
Yeah.
So we just have to reinstitute. He passed away, I think, in 2010 or 2009. Mm-hmm. We just have to reinstitute what has already been done. Now, you spoke of President Obama being a black man in the highest office. Now, I look at it like this. You, being a black man, you have the potential and the tendencies through the work you've already done to be a President Obama. So you would become President Watkins in your own community.
Yeah.
Just like they talk about policing your own communities.
Right.
You have to be that same commander-in-chief in your community, among those whom you sit among and who you have their ear and their eye gates. You have to carry yourself in that position. Then you start, I would say, deputizing others. You are president of your community. Yeah. This is how you act. And President Obama is our role model, is your role model.
There's no doubt about it.
I mean, this is real talk. I'm saying this.
There's no doubt.
It's just like every household, when it originally started out, had a man as the head. And everything was in order because there was the daddy, the mama, and the children. And then they say God is first, and then daddy followed God, and the mama followed daddy, and the children followed mom and daddy and God, and they were all one big happy family. So that is kind of, you know, throw it all out and kind of destroyed in so many ways, defeated in so many words. However, we have to reinstitute it. We have to reclaim it. We have to redeem it. And as I was saying, that model application that's in technology, the model family, the model neighborhood, the model household, what does it look like? What does it sound like? You know, what does it feel like? We have to implement that. You have stage plays. You understand? Movies.
Of course.
Television shows. Reality shows. There's a bunch of lies. We got to get into all of that.
Which leads me into
you
this
ready to
something.
Act?
I'm ready. That's part of it. I get a chance to do what I've been wanting to do most of my life.
Act?
Yeah.
What?
I'm a good actor.
Wow.
I've been keeping it for the last 55 years.
What?
Then you're bringing it out. I can do something right now.
Come on here. Bring it on me. Put it on me. Go ahead.
Judy.
Stop it.
No, I mean, I got to save that. But how much time we got?
You got about 5 minutes.
Oh, good. Because I wanted to say you bought into movies. Last time I was here in my own show, I bought up this, I'm dealing with a script.
Oh.
See, you don't even remember me talking about it. I told you before.
But anyway,
when I was here this time, because I said it all in a mumma gum, I was rushing and all that. I ain't rushing now. I'm going to take my time. I got 5 minutes.
You got 5 minutes.
This script is about a suburban young girl that came as a result of reading about me in a magazine.
Oh.
And she came to South Central Los Angeles to help. She was one of these type people that you got that wanted to do something, but they didn't know how. She came down, and I was over at the Brotherhood Crusade in their basement at the time.
Wow.
And she came and stayed and for many, a few months, many months, and she did a lot of things for us. They helped us out a lot.
Wow.
And, I was running for the 9th District office.
What?
And
Who were you running against?
Bob Gay and Rita Waters all that.
I remember
that.
Bob Gay.
Yeah,
Rita won?
Yeah. I didn't have enough money. I had the money that her name was Joanne. She helped me. See, I got the Shrine Auditorium.
What?
And Barry was with me, Barry White, and all of them. Barry was my friend.
What?
And we were there and had the Barry. She have a, help me. She helped me get to pay for it because that cost 10 grand for 3 hours.
No way.
Oh.
Back in the day.
Yeah, now it's probably more, it's much more than that now.
That's a shame.
But anyway, I had it, had my name on the marquee and all that kind of thing.
What?
And I was running
for it. Go, Leon.
But she did that kind of thing. She would go out and help us to in the community. She would go and do things. She had no fear, period. One day, one of the fellas came over from one of my sets that I deal with, and somebody had shot up his car, and he was coming to me for some money to fix it.
What?
Well, that's what they do. I can do it. I help. But I told him, I don't have no money for no holes today. For no bullet holes I'm talking about.
Oh, my goodness.
I don't have no money for that, But the point was that he was just like, you looking at me.
Okay.
Joanne would sit here. I had her behind a petition. She was supposed to been working.
Okay.
But I saw him, as you looking at me and your eyes go that way.
Uh-oh.
She was looking around.
Uh-oh.
He saw her.
Uh-oh.
She saw him, and I saw both of them. And I said, I said, no, it couldn't be. But I saw it.
Anyway. Oh, my gosh. Was it love at first sight?
Well, it ended up where Joanne ended up having a loving him and went on with him and helped him. They changed the whole thing though in that set.
They changed it to good.
She helped him good. He even changed.
Excellent.
They started going out doing all kind of stuff. There's all these big talk shows because they had changed.
What?
They had dealt with the race relations. They were dealing with that.
I love it.
In the sense strength that she was in the set with them. They accepted her and all the ladies and everything. And she was working in that and took him and. They did great things.
That's powerful. So now this great is a things. Part of your script.
This is the script. It's about how we. It's about the story about how we met, and how then she met Jay, and then they moved on.
Okay.
Did what
and
they had
did
to
good
do.
Things.
Did wonderful things.
That's awesome.
And fell in love. It's a really an actual love story.
Okay. So do you know how much money it takes to make this movie?
No, we just passing around. If you know somebody, you can give it to them. We've been shaping it. But I'm just saying to you, this is what I'm with, and that's my next project. When I get into the film thing, that's what I'm pushing.
Okay.
Because, see, I want her to come and be on our show, too, to talk about it from her perspective. You can ask her all the questions you have. I'm just saying that maybe we can split screen her or get on the phone or something when we got a show. Maybe one of these times, what I'm saying?
Skype and all that. Well, that's very interesting, and I think with technology, there are various ways to actually handle that situation. So I would definitely be interested in looking further into this.
Okay.
And seeing how we can really bring it to pass in a timely manner. We don't want to wait so long and draw it all out and put all the people in it and then they start changing it.
Yes.
There's several ways to do things nowadays. So, and it sounds like a very
good
one. It was a good, very good love story. It was a,
oh,
loving
yeah, it was.
Loving you is wrong. I don't want to be right.
Yeah,
said, like that's that. What came to my mind when I, really, when I was listening. Wrong with he that? Said, he looked, she looked, uh-oh.
They did. I mean, to me, I seen it.
You saw it.
I seen it.
I seen it
and
with
I
my
And I said,
own
oh,
eyes.
my. That's anyway, funny. It was one of the things. And, you know, it's a beautiful thing. You know, it should be told. Especially nowadays.
Well, tell it.
It should
and
be something out there telling,
show
showing.
It.
Show it should be.
And you know what? Movies
seen.
Put people to work.
Those yeah.
are
oh,
jobs.
Yeah. Definitely.
Jobs are created
Definitely.
With movies.
Definitely.
And you know what? Gil Garcetti is about films, bringing more films to
really?
The state of California.
Oh,
yes.
Yeah, because of the.
The Junior.
Yeah.
Gil Garcetti Jr.
Yeah, yeah.
Or
yeah.
Is,
no.
Is he Eric?
Eric? Gil? Eric.
Eric.
I think it's Eric. Eric,
Excuse
Gil.
Me. No, please.
Jim, something.
No,
I know
Eric.
It. It's Eric.
Eric, his daddy's
yeah.
Gil.
I don't know his
why
father.
I thought he was a Jew.
I don't know his daddy.
Yeah, Gil was the other one.
I don't know.
He was the. Okay, I'm going to stop talking before I get my.
I don't know him. I'm
it's
trying
to. Like, these people living in this city.
I'm trying to get
it
out of
it.
Man.
But anyway, yeah, Eric Garcetti is the one.
But I heard about it,
to
though.
Bring film
I heard
to
about
California
it.
Because that's a good industry, financial industry.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we'll present that.
Okay.
Anyway, our time is
All
moving.
Right.
We have like 0 minutes.
Trying, well, where's my music?
Which one you want? You want Live It Up? You want Get It
Ooh,
Together?
Ooh, Live It Up.
You want Live It Up? Okay, that was
Live It
Up.
Folks, until next time, God bless you and keep you.
You've been listening to
The Leon Watkins Show.
As well as watching.
And I'm thanking Mrs. Wells for being my special guest. Thank you.
She just made herself a guest.
It's all right.
All right, y'all. Thank you.
You never want to come for me. Oh, no. Knowing what you really need. You always say you had enough.